joining us during a busy week of lectures. We're honored and very pleased to welcome Detlef Mertens back into the building after a couple of years away. Before the introduction, if you could just pull your phone out and please click it off. It's a small room and they tend to be a bit disruptive. Thanks very much. Detlef's lecture this evening, Bioconstructivism, Biotechniques, and Biotechnology, looking at the early modern work of Lissitzky, Moholy-Nagy, and Kiesler, is a perfect title summary for a scholar like Detlef, who I think, in ways unlike almost anyone else, can connect a world of, let's say, Mies and Maya, or other early modernists and software that floats around the buildings like this today in remarkable ways, and I think provide a history for a certain kind of contemporary sensibility within modernism, which is of great interest to many of us today. A way to connect modernist figures and what you could say biomorphic figuration in all of its discussion and discourses today. It's something that Detlef can bring forward as a topic because of his incredible abilities as a historian and scholar in the culture of early modernism in architecture today, and his work as a great and leading contemporary educator in architecture, which for several years has been at the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia, where in 2003 Detlef was appointed chair of architecture in one of the United States' great schools of architecture. He joins us this evening back from Philadelphia. There is, I'm sure amongst you, some students from Philadelphia and Pennsylvania here today, and it's great to have you back. I think the Penn students have been with us now every autumn for several years, I would say 6 or 7 years, and it's a great way for us to start every year with a group of people coming over from that school, a little bit ahead of everyone else in the building, to start a project and work on the city from a different perspective than all of the studios in units, and it's a project that Detlef has been a part of for several years as a visiting critic during that work. He did his work in a PhD in architecture as part of an incredible generation of scholars working with Tony Vidler and others at Princeton University in the early 1990s, where he worked on Gideon and the as he titled it in his thesis, the prehistory of modern architecture, and it's a topic that he's returned to in many ways. While teaching at schools like Princeton, Columbia, Harvard, Rice, and I think a bit here at the AA over the years. And it's a great pleasure to welcome him back. He has written extensively on Mies van der Rohe and is currently working on a very large publication on that architect. About 13 or 14 years ago, he edited an absolutely classic book in contemporary architectural history and theory called The Presence of Mies, for those of you that have had a chance to see it, which brings together 8 or 10 remarkable scholars and critical theorists on the topic of Mies and early modernism. And this book is an opportunity in larger monographic form to carry some of that research forward. And please join me in welcoming Detlef Mertens.
Thank you so much, Brett, for that kind introduction. It's a real treat for me to be back at the AA. It's an anchor in the world of architectural culture that we all admire from a distance, and occasionally we're privileged enough to be able to come into your sanctum. I really mean that. I mean, I think what the AA has done over the years and continues to do so vigorously inspires architectural education around the world. My hat's off, as always. My talk tonight is part of a... Oh, you know what I probably should have done is gotten rid of the timer on there, but so it may act up on us. This talk is part of a larger project of rereading the history of modernism once again, this time through the lens of biology, the reception of biology and the life sciences among architects, artists, engineers, people who we generally associate with constructivist or technologically based design, which is to say, largely, in fact, outside the framework of biomorphism, which has become so dominant in our conception of biologistic approaches to design. I first discovered this topic while working on Mies. Some of you may know essays that I published for two catalogs a number of years ago, where I began to dive into his own readings of science, and particularly also biology, and to speculate on how that, in fact, might work. How would an architect like Mies possibly be interested in biology? If his first designs for glass skyscrapers seem to be formally reminiscent of crystals, like his entry to the Friedrichstrasse skyscraper competition of 1921, which he himself called honeycomb, or reminiscent of amoebas, like his second curvilinear scheme of 1922, they were not actually intended to be in any way formally mimetic of anything, certainly not historical styles, but also not any given form already, but rather to be demonstrative of a generative process of making form from first or inner principles. The role of biological models for engineers like Fry Otto and Buckminster Fuller later in the 20th century is something that Lars Spreubeck asked me to write about in his book Knox, Machining Architecture. And it's certainly a topic that is very resonant among contemporary designers and in schools like this one, my own. Interestingly enough, it's resonant across a pretty wide range of persuasions from formalist and morphogenesis to high-tech, ecotech, various species of sustainability, and biomimicry. This is a plate for Arup, in fact, an advertisement of Arup that captures, I think, some of that spirit across a pretty broad range of what we think of as a pretty broad range of design tendencies. At Penn, we certainly have also had many of these directions represented among our faculty and in the work of our recent graduates, as well as in a deep history that stretches back to the 1950s when the French structural engineer Robert Le Ricollet was inspired by the same microscopic sea creatures that still fascinate Lars Spreubeck today. More recently at Penn, Cecil Balmond established a research unit called the Nonlinear Systems Organization, together with David Rue and several other colleagues, to mine the potentials of complexity science and mathematics for contemporary work. It was from Cecil, however, that I learned the lesson that while the geometry of most of nature is complex and nonlinear, the orthogonal world that we humans have come to treat as our reality is still a legitimate subset. Limited, perhaps, but not, in fact, unnatural. So in a sense, the research I'm going to show you tonight seeks to explore not only a prehistory of contemporary interests in biology and design, but also the possibility of some common ground between directions in design that are often seen as divergent, if not antagonistic. I want to look in some detail at three figures who were artists rather than architects or engineers, but who sought to extend their art into a new architecture, a new environmental paradigm, and also a paradigm of method, a paradigm of design. I coined the term bioconstructivism a number of years ago to register the importance of biology, biologistic thought, a biocentric worldview, for the species of constructivism that some of these figures represent, the Russian Lissitzky, the Hungarian Laszlo Moholy-Nagy, particularly, both of whom came to Berlin in 1921. I'm also going to be looking at Friedrich Kiesler toward the end of this talk, who is not associated really with constructivism, but who drew on biology in the late 1930s in a way that extended the theories of biotechnics that had been promoted in the 1920s by Moholy-Nagy and Lissitzky. Let me be clear then that the term bioconstructivism is not in fact a term that was used at the time. It wasn't a manifesto term, a programmatic term, or even a term that critics used. I've invented it retroactively and somewhat opportunistically just to underscore that this work we think of as technologically based is was for them in fact inspired by principles in nature. In doing this kind of thing, I'm also following a friend of mine named Oliver Botar, who reconstructed some years ago the discourse on biocentrism in Central Europe during the period between the two wars. While the term biotechnic, biocentric, too, was not a master term of the period, It was used by the Hungarian artist Erno Kallel, who did help pioneer biomorphic work in visual arts, to designate a break from the anthropocentric focus in the Western tradition, which was in fact shared by many others, philosophers, scientists, sociologists, pseudoscientists, and artists. In an essay of 1992, the historian Joseph Rickwert reminds us that the terms organic and mechanical were almost synonymous in the original Greek rather than opposed. Machina and machinus referred to any kind of contrivance coming from the Greek makos, which designated a means, an expedient, or a remedy. Organon came from an Arabic term, ergon, or work. They only became opposed during the Enlightenment, and almost immediately, counter-Enlightenment responses sought to bring them back together again. While organic worldviews have often been opposed to mechanical ones, in fact, they evolved not in isolation of one another, but rather through interaction. These interactions have, however, taken place over many generations and involved many different individuals operating in different historical and social situations and with different scientific models and technologies. As a result, collectively, they produced a rather heterogeneous body of work and theory that can often be confusing in its proliferation, contradictions, and resistance to assimilation to a single paradigm. In many ways, we could say that what they share most is a goal rather than the proposition that fulfills that goal. By the early 20th century, both mechanistic and organic theories in science and philosophy had been significantly transformed and ceased to be clearly distinguished. Consider, for instance, how the wave theory of light and the theory of electromagnetic fields challenged atomism and reductionism of the 19th century and gave rise after 1900 to a host of new theories that effectively superseded the opposition of vitalism and mechanism. The new organicism posited the wholeness of organizational systems as being prior to any analysis of parts. Einstein's relativity theory redefined the universe in terms of change, events, and relationships. Quantum mechanics transcended the distinction between wave and particle, and theories of implicate order began to treat atomism as a simplification valid only in some contexts, yet I would hasten to underscore still valid in those contexts. In the 1920s, Alfred North Whitehead saw the manifold of occurrences in nature as belonging to an undivided structure of evolving processes. Some years earlier, Georg Simmel marked a similar turn in philosophy in his essay of 1904 called Kant and Goethe. After reviewing both the strengths and weaknesses of what he called Kant's mechanistic worldview and Goethe's organic one, Simmel concluded that the coming epoch would reject any half-hearted mediation between them, would not so much reconcile their conceptual differences as negate them through the fact of the lived experience of them. The future would be, he said, under the sign of Kant and Goethe. It was in this context, then, that artists and architects began to think about industrial technology as belonging to nature, not in opposition to it, or at least having its essence and telos, its logical end, in a new nature, one that would overcome the antinomy of the human and the natural. There I am, I've lost my images, right? Coming out of the suprematism of Kazimierz Malevich, Lissitzky is remembered most for his work in photography, typography, graphic design, and exhibition design, as well as his role as cultural emissary in Europe for the newly formed Soviet state, particularly between 1921 and 25. But he also sought to move from two dimensions into three dimensions, into a new kind of spatial environment that would be abstract and non-representational, yet real, that would in fact be the world, understood as both natural and human, historical and universal. While Lissitzky was a student of suprematism, of pure painting imbued with spiritual values, he also admired Vladimir Tatlin, who looked to materials and technology. Lissitzky designed this tribune for Lenin in 1920, demonstrating his search for a new paradigm that combined the formal and geometric with the material and technological, all the while still never giving priority to the abstract. The tribune was to be made of iron, eternite, and glass, and featured a cantilevered iron strut 12 meters high. The cube at the bottom was to be transparent and house the motor that would set things in motion. A glass elevator could transport several people at a time to the lower balcony, where they would wait until their turn came to speak from the upper balcony. The upper platform would shift forward, thrusting the speaker toward the audience and into space. The screen above could display maxims and newsreels. The diagonal drama of the ensemble would accentuate the gestures of the speaker. A similarly dramatic project of the mid-1920s was Lissitzky's Wolkenbügel, or skyhooks, literally cloud stirrups, of 1924. Here he envisaged that several of these would be built at major intersections of the Ring Boulevard of Moscow with its radial avenues. They were horizontally organized office buildings lifted into the air on three vertical supports, which would also provide stairs and elevators, one directly to the metro station below ground. Traffic would gain space and the street would remain light and airy while introducing a new metropolitan building type, the office building, for new metropolitan subjects, office workers, and providing points of orientation within and at the scale of the metropolis. Lissitzky's interest in biology becomes evident in an issue of Kurt Schwitter's journal, Mertz, the issue of April and June 1924, titled Nasky, which Lissitzky co-edited with Schwitter's. Nasky is derived from the Latin word meaning nature. It alludes to becoming and autogenesis and approximates the German term Gestaltung. For Lissitzky and Schwitter's, Nasky designated, quote, everything that develops, moves, and forms itself out of itself through its own strength. Lissitzky's introduction begins by declaring, rather surprisingly, we have had enough of perpetually hearing machine, machine, machine when it comes to the production of art. This is surprising given Lissitzky's preference for new media and technology, perhaps less so if we remember that, like Schwitter's, he was critical of the hegemony of technology in art. He sought to favor the abstract and aesthetic, in fact, over the technological, and he had a commitment to the organic. His utopian vision of world reconstruction required coordination precisely among these three domains, nature, technology, and art. Or as he put it in his inscription at the bottom of this photogram of 1924, it's a hard thing to read, it's at the very, very bottom, nature plus technology plus art equals the square root of -1 equals I. I'm not sure what that means, I mean, but it's true for sure. Although this image was not reproduced in Mertz, I'm gonna leave it up because I think it's such a great image and great example of his photo-based work. The machine, Lissitzky continued, is no more than a brush and a very primitive one at that. All tools set forces in motion, which are directed to the crystallizing of amorphous nature, which is the aim of nature itself. For Lissitzky, then, mining the constructive potentials of industrial technology meant seeing it as part of the larger natural cosmos. More precisely, it meant seeing that the potential of technology rested on refining it and using it not in opposition to nature, but as an extension of nature. And it's a crucial distinction. It's an extension of nature. He wrote, "The machine has not separated us from nature. Through it, we have discovered a new nature never before surmised. Our work is not a philosophy and not a system for acquiring knowledge of nature. Rather, it is a limb of nature itself, and as such can present itself only as an object of cognition. We wish to design peace," he continued, "the peace of nature in which enormous tensions hold the heavenly bodies rotating uniformly in equal balance." Like an engineer, Lissitzky sought to manipulate the laws of physics and mechanics in the service of invention. He observed that modern art and modern science had each reduced form to its basic elements, the one working intuitively, the other rationally, in order to then construct a new, yet within nature's processes and laws. Like others at that time, more interested in becoming than in being, he noted that from the perspective of nature, form assumed a different status. No longer a value or end in itself, form was now simply the result of constitutive processes, and a temporary result at that. Both science and art, he noted, had arrived at the same formula, quote, every form is the frozen instantaneous picture of a process. Thus a work is a stopping point on the road to becoming, and not the fixed goal. Readers of Bergson will no doubt hear a certain resonance with his discussion of film and creative evolution, which was, after all, already published in French in 1907 and already and finally translated into German, one could say finally, in 1921. The body of the Nasky issue presented a portfolio of such snapshots in a wide range of media and creative practices by artists, architects, and in culture at large, evidence according to Lissitzky that a new collective will was already beginning to govern international art production, the will to constructions rather than representations, to element inventions, plural creations, unity in variety. To emphasize the elemental character of this work, building up from simple to complex phenomena, Lissitzky began by presenting Malevich's Black Square of 1915, the degree zero of suprematism, from which a seemingly infinite combinatorial system had been born. We acknowledge works, he wrote, which contain a system within themselves, a system which has not been evolved before the work started, but has evolved in the course of it. So, beautiful, radical formulation, it seems to me, of system theory. More radical than most today. As the folio opens up, Lissitzky explains that all of creation is the result of seven fundamental technical forms: the crystal, the sphere, the plane, the rod, ribbon, screw, and cylinder. Everything in the universe, architecture, machine elements, crystals and chemicals, geography and astronomical formations, art and technology, he says, was built up from these fundamental building blocks. On the facing page, he presents one of his own prouds, his own works of art, as demonstrative of this constructive principle. Turning the page, we find an oil painting by Mondrian and a collage by Schwitters, a sculpture by Arkhipenko, and another collage by Hans Arp, this time with a sideways reference to Dada in the gutter. Mies's glass skyscraper, the second curvilinear one with the amoeboid plan, paired with a femur bone and a de Stael pavilion by J.J.P. Oud. A graphic work by Fernand Léger and Tatlin's Monument of the Third International. An aerial view of a geometrically ordered farm landscape in Switzerland, top left, an abstracted view through a theater marquee on the far left, and the flower of a plant. I still can't quite get all of those together in my mind. And another collage, this time by Georges Braque, and a rather crystalline photogram by Man Ray. That's basically the issue of the journal. The sequence concludes with this unidentified image, an enigmatic image of something akin to a cell seen through a microscope, punctuated with a question mark. Notwithstanding the claims to have discovered the underlying universal elements of all creation, one of the things that is most extraordinary about this collection is, in fact, its heterogeneity. Of course, some of it may be attributed to the collaboration with Schwitters, whose approach to the organic was different, more alchemical, relying on the transformation of materially given things and producing synthesis through the interaction and merger of opposites. But the idea of unity in diversity had been a recurring theme in systematic thought, like Lissitzky's, since antiquity. In geometry, as in the appreciation of nature's fecundity, and had been given a strategic role even in Darwin's theory of evolution. In The Origin of Species of 1859, Darwin posited that all life was derived from a single and simple source, and that evolution proceeds through diversity coupled with the filter of natural selection. He begins famously with the sentence, "From so simple a beginning, endless forms most beautiful have been and are being evolved." Makes one wonder if Malevich too had read Darwin. Certainly Malevich's paintings demonstrated how complexity can be built up from the most irreducible elements, beginning, let's say, with a square, then a cross, a checkerboard, a circle in a square, a tilted white square, a red square with a black square, aggregating more elements, and even more elements, and ultimately extending into three-dimensional architectural form in the Alpha Architecton of 1920. If we now look at Lissitzky's early work of 1919 and 20, we can see how he reinterpreted Malevich's system to to formulate his own program of world reconstruction under the banner of PROWN, which is an acronym for Project for the Affirmation of the New. PROWNs were dynamic configurations of overlapping and intersecting planes and also masses, creating form and space by means of what he called economic constructions of material. PROWN, he wrote, is leading us to construct a new body in a space in which emptiness, chaos, and the unnatural become order, certainty, and plastic form. PROWN was from the start architectural and urban in scope as Lissitzky sought to define a new environment that would be both abstract and real, artistic, yet the space of everyday life. This painting from 1919 was even called Town, or Town PROWN. It was first shown in 1922 at the first Russian exhibition in Berlin, which Lissitzky organized. Where some of Lissitzky's paintings emphasized three-dimensional masses, others featured planes of different colors floating in space, intersecting to form assemblages, some of which suggested not objects as much as spatial environments that could be occupied, such as this one. I'm interested in how, in such a milieu, there seems to be no gravity, no clear up or down, how Lissitzky aspired to a new kind of topsy-turvy spatiality in which people, too, could become floating elements. He attempted to develop a fully three-dimensional version of it in a series of exhibition spaces, beginning with the Proun Room of 1923, a rather awkward, I think, and literal transposition of elements from painting into architecture. Lissitzky's sketches and photo collages capture the ambition perhaps even better than the built installation. As I mentioned at the outset, Lissitzky had also admired Tatlin and sought to combine something of his material technological assemblages with the formal geometric system of Malevich. Tatlin had, of course, himself already done something like this with his proposal for the monument to the Third International. A government building with an open and dynamic iron structure. It's supposed to be a huge building, right? Like the leg of the Eiffel Tower, within which assembly halls in different elementary volumes, a cube, a pyramid, a cylinder, and hemisphere, were suspended, suggesting instability yet equilibrium at the same time. Like celestial bodies, they were to rotate on their axis at different speeds. The pyramid was to complete its orbit once a month, the cylinder once a day. In Naski, Lissitzky describes such forms not as platonic solids, as Le Corbusier might, but as technical forms. But what would he have understood by that term, a technical form? And how would that have differed from other kinds of form, architectural forms or art forms? I want to answer that question indirectly, because I don't know of a direct source to draw on. And I'm going to do it in two indirect ways, one of which is through this treatise of 1907 called Eisenbauten Iron Structures by Alfred Gotthold Meyer, which was the first history of iron constructions in the 19th century. As the frontispiece of the bridge over the Firth of Forth suggests, Meyer was sensitive to the new beauty, sharp, steely, and sublime of iron bridges, train stations, and exhibition buildings of the late 19th century. He distinguished technical form from architectural form, much like Karl Bertecke had distinguished between Kernform and Kunstform, except that Meyer was more deliberate in working from the perspective of engineering, and so emphasized that technical forms were derived from calculation. They were mathematized and geometricized pieces of matter, something akin to synthetic crystals. Consider these pages where he explores the profiles that have been developed for extrusions in iron, the I, H, and T sections that would become so ubiquitous in the 20th century, as well as hollow tubes, both round and square. He called these the ur elements of iron construction, or the images of different kinds of beams constructed by assembly, bolting together smaller elemental units of iron to create trusses and beams for bridges or for long span roof structures. He emphasized that the new architecture emerging through the industrialization of iron was not one of forming, as with stone, but of assembly, as exemplified by the Crystal Palace of 1851. And he differentiated between architects who assimilated the new material to old ornamental styles, as here on the left in the Neues Museum in Berlin, And those who, like Berlage, the Dutch Berlage, used iron structures in a straightforward and unsentimental way, objective, sachlich, like an engineer, and finding new aesthetic value in that. Inherent in this new architecture was a new sense of space, which Meyer described in terms of a new breadth, as in train stations and exhibition halls, train stations like St. Pancras Station here in London, which I just saw yesterday in its restored form, which is unbelievably beautiful. And also a new height, as represented, oops, there's still the great new breadth, the exhibition gallery of machines in 1889 in Paris, and a new height. So these are the categories for Meyer of a new aesthetic, the breadth of scale, the height of scale, a kind of new infinite scope, a sublime, technological sublime. The second way of approaching what a technical form might have meant, I want to use here the photography of Albert Ranger-Potch from the late 1920s to give us some sense of the appreciation for technical forms in cultural terms in those years. Images of machines as animate assemblages of irreducible elements that are doing work, of the standardization of raw material into mathematized units of lumber, of the serial reproduction of products and building components, but also of a decidedly ambivalent attitude towards modernization, the exploitation of nature and alienation of labor. This ambivalence was shared by many of the figures that I'm talking about. It was also clearly registered in Mies's images of the glass skyscraper, which I showed before, which he continued to work on well into the 1920s. If we look back at this remarkable and complex image of it, we're struck by its heroic embrace of the most advanced industrial construction, which he frankly didn't know much about at the time, and the powerfully melancholic effects that he sought to produce in this rendering. With glass, he fashioned the skyscraper into a giant crystal, a piece of inorganic nature, shimmering as it erupted. Let me go back for a second, I moved too fast. Shimmering as it erupted from the ground, breaking through the dark metropolis of the 19th century, a figure of growth, becoming, and rebirth, an architectonic phoenix suggesting a luminous and redemptive future just around the corner, an architecture at once natural and transcendental. Like a Gothic cathedral, it dematerializes as it rises to the heavens from which the fallen conditions, from within the fallen conditions of the city of modernity. With his second version, he even exploited a biomorphic form, underscoring, however, that it was generated by non-formal logics, by the demands of structure on the one hand, and the desires for perceptual affects of reflection and transparency on the other. It was this version that Lissitzky and Schwitters juxtaposed in the Natsky issue of their journal to a femur bone, suggesting commonalities of design method and elements, especially in how the forms serve structural functions. At the bottom of the page, they quoted Mies, "We know no forms, only building problems. Form is not the goal, but the result of our work. There is no form in and for itself." Now, these words came from Mies's manifesto called Building, published in the journal G, Material for Elementary Design, the previous year, along with his theoretical project for a concrete country house. Mies's experimental projects of this time and the texts that accompanied them make clear that he had already been rethinking the basis of architecture to follow the principles of nature, especially the organic process of form generation or Gestaltung. Let me explain that term a little bit more. The term Gestaltung, which is featured in the title of this journal, with which both Mies and Lissitzky were involved, Lissitzky designed the first issue, for instance, had become a new watchword for those looking to replace the concepts of style and representation. It referred to the process of form creation rather than form as such, and implied that form was nothing more than the result of generative procedures. It implied the idea of a process form and had already been used in technical discourse, industrial design, as well as aesthetics and biology. It came to designate self-generation from inner functions or purposes made visible in outer form. The theory of Gestaltung took the classical conception of the relationship of parts to wholes and updated it to the world of complex machines and organisms, which were understood to be built up from elemental units or atoms, to be energetic, functional, and performative. In this context, pure form and biological principles were invoked not to perpetuate industrial modernity, but rather to mitigate its problematics, to tame the beast and redirect its extraordinary capabilities toward a new organic society and culture. Lissitzky prepared the journal Natsky while being treated for pulmonary tuberculosis in a sanatorium outside of Locarno, Switzerland. He'd come down with pneumonia while in Hanover in August 1923. Shortly thereafter, an X-ray revealed signs of tuberculosis. Perhaps it was this experience, perhaps even the X-rays themselves, that prompted him to become explicit about his understanding of technology as potentially organic, or even more precisely, as extending human capabilities to account for ever more aspects of nature, to cure disease and improve life. Our work, he had written in Natsky after, is a limb of nature. In a letter to his wife, written from the hospital, he referred to an excerpt from a book by Raoul H. Francais, a botanist, published in the art journal Das Kunstblatt in January 1923, which may also have triggered his new enthusiasm for biology. The book was titled The Plant as Inventor, and had followed another similar book of the previous year, The Technical Accomplishments of Plants. Lissitzky's letter also asks that she be sure to buy Francais's more recent book called Bios, or The Laws of the World. He wrote, I should very much like to make personal contact with him. We must find out his address without fail. When Natsky is finished, I will send him a copy with a dedication. In his books, Francais called nature the greatest of inventors. Well, and of course that's a kind of cliche, but he took it quite literally. I'm going to focus on static and mechanical inventions, but he also speaks of chemical ones, which is very interesting. By imitating nature, all human problems, he said, could be solved. Governed by natural laws, Francais was impressed that nature managed to produce an immense plurality of existence rather than uniformity. He called the universal a complex system constructed of different parts, each part having its own nature and qualities, contributing to existence as an ongoing and constitutive process in which, quote, world and processes of the world melt into one. He also reiterated the ancient Pythagorean proposition that the material world, be it organic or inorganic, was inherently mathematical in structure. So we don't have a division here between mathematics and biology, but rather, in fact, the two are already understood together. And he pointed to parallels between the inventions of plants and of humans, suggesting, for instance, that the prototypes of ship propellers could be found in maple keys, or microorganisms that propel themselves through water by rotation. He showed an invention of his own, a salt shaker modeled after the functionality of a seed pod, which turned out, I think, not to be particularly effective and did not go into production. And he showed this femur bone, which is the one that Lissitzky redrew for the journal. And maybe I should say something more about this because it is an image that recurs in many treatises. Of course, it's also in Darcy Thompson's On Growth and Form, and has been commented on by many, or used at least by many people. So the femur bone was held up as an exemplar of how a form could manifest itself, how a form could manifest the forces that were at play. So it's a hip bone, and its purpose is primarily to transfer the weight of the torso into the legs, right, to distribute it from a central position into two legs. So that's the first part of it. But then in addition, what the scientists all underscored was that there are these lines on the surface of the femur bone that further identify the forces at work in its structural role. Francais also showed, cross sections of plant stems, of grass stems, like the one on the left, and compared them to iron structures that used I-beams or H-sections. In this case, there's a more complex one shown on the right where there are rings of structure inside each other in a grass stem, and they're compared to the foundations of an unidentified high-rise building in America and an exposed timber structure in a medieval town in Germany. Francais also cited the more crystalline variants of the radiolarians, the single-celled sea creatures that Ernst Haeckel had discovered in the 1860s and popularized around 1900, that Buckminster Fuller later referred to, that Robert Le Ricollet referred to, that Fry Otto referred to, and that Lars Breubeck still refers to. These creatures were seen to be exemplary of elemental constructivism at the microscopic level. For Francais, biotechnics, which is the term for the theory that he was promoting, was not a call to copy the forms of nature, but rather to understand the fundamental laws of nature's constructive activities and apply them to the design and manufacture of new products and also of new ways of doing things, new procedures. By following the principles of nature, human technologies could also achieve their optimal form. These are now the criteria of organic performance, could employ the least material, effort, and energy, could achieve integration and harmony within the whole of existence, and promote human health and well-being. These are the principles of the bios for Lissitzky, for Francais, and then subsequently for his various readers. In a sense, Francais' theory of bios provided the scientific basis for the theory of design as Gestaltung. It was on the pages of The Plant as Inventor that Lissitzky found the idea that all of creation is a product of seven basic technical forms. He reiterated Francais' description of these almost verbatim in his text in Natsky. Here was the formula of life and all mechanics, industry and architecture, wrote Francais, all the ideas of the artists from the builders of the pyramids to the expressionists, the experimenters of the present, he called them. Francais' reference to expressionists would surely have provoked Lissitzky as well as Mies and Moholy-Nagy, who were decidedly anti-expressionist. Now, to explain this a little further, consider the shape of a screw, for instance, which he describes as being adapted by everything that has the function of boring and squeezing through. We ourselves did not invent the screw, he writes, the gimlet and the propeller, nor did the bacteria, the scourging infusoria, or the plants, nor yet the wind which moves most rapidly in spiral windings. The natural law, deeply embedded in the structure of the world, that stands behind all these occurrences, is that spiral movement occurs with less expenditure of energy than movement in a straight line. Where today, evolutionary biologists such as Lynn Margulis looked to bacteria as the original and simplest forms of life, or Sean Carroll looks to what he calls immortal genes, Francais took protoplasm to be the simplest form of life and the cell to be its bodily form. He described protoplasm as fluid and elastic and considered the cell an optimal form for the functions of life because it is, quote, formless and capable of taking every form. Perhaps it was this that Lissitzky had in mind with the final image of Natsky. Actually, I'm going to go back. Francais observed that profusion was evident not only in the structures built up of cells, but also within the cell, where another world of cells may be discerned. The smaller, still smaller cornerstones of life, which he called combs, and which form cells in the same manner as cells form organisms. Within these combs, he found still smaller granules, threads, ribbons, spirals, and small prisms, muscle fibers, nerve cells, and a whole star system, he said, of most delicate threads, which is developed in every cell when it divides. The cell, he continued, has a form for every function. A system of tensions changing in 100 varieties becomes a crystallized form. Wherever tension and pressure have to perform the same tasks, the same crystal form grows up, be it deeply hidden in the interior part of an iron girder, in a stiff, dark, porphyry rock 1,000 yards under the sunny fields, or in the cell form of a glistening green stem, or in a figure great or small made by human hands. For Francais, then, the world is an eternal flowing of the same things, a return of similar laws only in different intensities, he writes, and scales. The forms and laws of unicellular life recur in higher stages, in higher degrees of intensity. The same mechanical system universally regulates the entire activity of life. He called this the law of degrees of integration. Now, with all this in mind, all this which Lissitzky was reading and enthused about, we look again at Lissitzky's Proun from the Natsky issue of Merits, tensions held in balance precariously, and his project for the skyhooks in the intersections of Moscow of the same time. In fact, Lissitzky's issue of Natsky and this project are absolutely concurrent and are right on the come right on the heels of his enthusiasm for Francais. Both may then be seen as contingent crystallizations of forces, tensions, and pressures. In the case of the skyhooks, the assembly of elements were technological and functional in character, geometric technical elements in concrete, metal, and glass, brought together in configurations by biomechanical forces. In summary, then, we find in Lissitzky a conception of constructive activity modeled on how nature builds and behaves across scales, from the micro to the macro, employing the same irreducible elements in accordance with the same laws of functionality, economy of means, and optimization as found in nature, to produce new entities of great diversity, which hold the dynamic forces of the universe momentarily in balance, integrated and in harmony with the cosmos. By 1924, the cosmology within which he had launched the Proun project had become biologistic, not only in terms of construction, but also energy and interactivity, yet without recourse to biomorphic forms. To us, this may seem strange, since we are certainly accustomed to seeing biologistic intentions manifest only or primarily in biomorphic forms. But Lissitzky, like Mies and Moholy, was fully engaged in the industrial revolution of the early 20th century. It didn't know biomorphic potentials, didn't know that. Sought to find a new nature through the technology at hand rather than against it. To see the potential of a new nature in what was still mechanical technology, but which they thought would be in its last and final stage before another great transformation. Now, my second figure is the Hungarian constructivist suprematist Laszlo Moholy-Nagy, a contemporary of Lissitzky who came to Berlin at the same time and became a key protagonist in shifting the Bauhaus toward constructivism and objective design method. Like Lissitzky, he became a reader of Francais, but inflected his biotechnics towards dematerialization, elemental integration, spatial fluidity, and dynamic constructions that elicited participation. Like Lissitzky, Moholy's early paintings, woodcuts, and lithographs, this is from 1920, were elemental constructions that sought to embody movement in static images. This was called, in fact, glass architecture. Or this somewhat later and more sophisticated of his so-called transparent paintings also demonstrate these attributes. In his book From Material to Architecture of 1929, in which he summarized his teaching at the Bauhaus, he outlined an historical progression from solid blocks to transparent or virtual structures, supporting figures floating in space, and transparent architecture. He showed stage sets for Tales of Hoffman, play staged in 1925, and photograms that were pure constructions of light in the dark room, some of which approximated microscopic imagery. Informed by the new optics of scientific photography, he became fascinated by evidence of structural continuities across scales of material phenomena, which he described in terms of facture. This is, in effect, a photographic version of the principles that Francais had outlined of continuity across different scales. Microscopic images of tissues and structures of inorganic materials and of living organisms, but also of human settlements, let's see if we can, like this, and even traffic patterns and flows. And finally, at the largest scale, organizations of celestial galaxies. So he's looking into finding patterns across all these scales. If many of these images are already about movement, about structure and patterns in motion, Moholy's sculpture from the early to the late 1920s projected dynamics into three-dimensional form, especially rotational and spiraling dynamics, and incorporated the movement of the observer, transforming the observer into a participant. That's a key idea for him. He conceived of space as space creation, Raumgestaltung, not the Cartesian empty space in which objects are located, but a phenomenological and psychophysiological space produced through the interweaving of subject and object, space and time, inside and outside. Space was, for him, produced in the sensorium and through interaction with the environment. He found it in amusement parks, elevator shafts, virtual figures of moving lights, another stage set by Norm Gabo, and attempted to simulate it using what he called the light space modulator constructed in 1929 and 30. This was an apparatus that had several different rotating platforms, so all the components that you're seeing were in fact spinning around and weaving into one another. What the object doesn't show you is that its purpose was really to serve as a prop for making a film. It was set inside a very large drum that was lined with little electric light bulbs. And once they were turned on, the camera started to move. Many of you have probably already seen this this film, but I brought a clipping of a clip of it just to remind us of Lissitzky's of what Moholy was trying to achieve. I think in many ways this was as close to architecture as he could get. This was the architecture that Moholy-Nagy envisaged as the future. And like Lissitzky, it's one of floating in space. Where is the observer here? Where is the eye? Where is the body? It's in the interwoven in amongst all of this dynamic motion. Okay. Now, I've wanted to bring another movie, another film with me, which is very different. It's very recent. And in a way to try to play with the potential affinities or continuities between Moholy's technologically media-based work that I've just been showing and a contemporary simulation of the inner life of the cell. This is a video prepared by scientists at Harvard that I'm going to also show you with a sound overlay by Peter Davies, who is the director of the Institute for Medicine and Engineering at Penn, with whom we've been doing collaborations. And he'll describe what it is that you're going to be looking at. Can we get the sound up?
Scale. And there are two scales. The first scale is shown here, and that is cells in the blood, some of them at the periphery, and they're rolling over a surface of lining of the blood. And that's what we as cell biologists really regard as a macro scale. And here you see now a scale lower where the surface of the rolling cell is coming into juxtaposition with the cell it's going to interact with, and now at the molecular level is engaging specific proteins in order to anchor it to the cell that it's going to move through. It's going to move through the monolayer of cells that it's come into contact with. So at the molecular scale, we have a very complex series of events. And what's going on inside both of these cells is that there are membranes. Those membranes, that sea of lipids and sea of proteins, constantly in motion. And this is the second message of this, not just scale, but dynamics. Because everything that's going on in the cell all the time has a rate constant attached to its dynamic turnover, whether it's slow or fast, and some indeed are extremely fast. And some are going on, all of what you're seeing here is going on constitutively, it's going on all the time. It's not something, we're not looking at a superimposed signaling event which accelerates some of these processes. And here you're seeing probably spectrin or a molecule in the cortical giving structure to that membrane, which is lipids and proteins, which doesn't have much much form, in a scientific sense. But in fact, the cytoskeleton, such as this example shown here, which is probably actin filaments throughout the cell and underneath the membranes, gives the cell its structural characteristics. But in turn, these elements are also dynamic, as you'll see in a moment. They're constantly being formed and unformed. Here you see them actually as being polymerization of this filament. And you see that the individual units coming together to form a filament of defined structure and, of course, a subsequent function. In a moment, you'll see the opposite of that, because in parts of the cell where this is going on, there will be other parts of the filamentous network, which gives the cell structure, which involves a cleavage event. And here's an enzyme now, which is going to cleave that structure, and there it dissociates. So you see disassembly of, and it falls apart, can fall apart under controlled conditions. The opposite of that elsewhere in these filaments is self-assembly. And here it may be catalyzed distantly from this particular site, or it may in fact be spontaneous self-assembly, the lowest free energy state being desirable. And elsewhere you'll see disassembly, where the units, again for reasons which may be entirely local, perhaps a local pH shift, are causing this change. Those filaments are pathways in the cell, and one pathway is carried out by motor proteins, and these proteins actually...
I'm going to cut it at the cartoon motor protein. Stay tuned for new Saturday morning entertainment. I think, for me, when I saw this video, this simulation, it made clearer to me still the extent to which Moholy's intuition was to try to make something that simulated ongoing constitutive dynamic cellular construction. It was clearly not as articulate, it wasn't as scientific, but I think that there was a kind of intuition at work that was headed in this direction. Third figure I want to talk on, this will be rather brief, is the Viennese Friedrich Kiesler, artist, designer, architect, whose career was launched by this rather remarkable installation in Vienna in 1924, the L&T installation system for the International Exhibition of New Theater Techniques. Here, Kiesler converted the fixed spatial constructs of the Stahl, such as Gerrit Rietveld's furniture and various buildings, into a flexible space and suspension system for the display of two- and three-dimensional objects. Standing 12 to 15 feet high and painted red, white, and black, this was the largest Stahl environment of the 1920s. A year later, Kiesler built another construction of comparable scale, the City and Space, for the International Exhibition of Decorative Arts and Modern Industry in Paris. Commissioned as a support system for the display of Austrian set designs and theater design, Kiesler also presented it as the prototype for a utopian megacity, which the artists of Stahl appreciated as a pure neoplastic spatial experiment. In presenting the City in Space in the pages of the journal Stahl, Kiesler celebrated the abolition of walls, which he called armor for body and soul, in this decentralized city, and suggested that its flexibility made it not only a functional architecture, but a Vitalbau, a vital construction, a constructive system finally adequate to the elasticity of life functions and to creating new kinds of living, and through them, the demands, he said, that would remold society. Now, leaping ahead 14 years, in an article of 1939, written after he had moved to America and published in the journal Architectural Record, Kiesler suggested that it was this Vitalbau that first started him thinking about what he would now call co-realism and biotechniques, which was the title of his article. Kiesler's text outlines what he called a new approach to building design based on science, more specifically on the fundamental laws which seem to govern man as a nucleus of forces. If Lissitzky provided the idea of a system of construction based on natural processes and principles and capable of producing complexity and diversity, and if Moholy rearticulated that as a dynamic system of ongoing constitutive activity and emphasized the generation of space and the expansion of human perception, in the late 1930s, Kiesler inflected this trajectory of thought by incorporating ideas of evolution, ecology, environment, and interaction between humanity and environment. He coined the science of co-realism to study what he called the dynamics of continual interaction between man and his natural and technological environments. Today we would probably call that coevolution. He began his article with a diagram titled, this diagram, titled Man Equals Heredity Plus Environment, which he explained expresses both the continual action of the total environment on man and the continual interaction of its constituent parts on one another. Kiesler's text introduced a new emphasis on continuity, heredity, and transformation through evolution, rather than the idea of creation from nothing. Creatio ex nihilo. Man, he wrote, is born in evolution of hereditary trends. He is the nucleus of forces, energies, and psychochemical reactions which act upon him and upon which he acts. He characterized life as the expression of biological interdependence among organisms, the cooperation, jostling, and strife of individual with individual and of species with species. Forms, be they natural or artificial, were, he said, only the visible trading posts of integrating and disintegrating forces, mutating at low rates of speed. With this image, Kiesler explained that the basic organization of the biological cell on the left, the chemical cell in the middle, and the electrical cell on the right are all similar, although the forces involved are expressed in different ways. Once again, a kind of demonstration of the principles of integration that Francais articulated and that we saw in different ways in Moholy-Nagy. I was recently at a conference with the evolutionary biologist Mark Kirschner, where Kirschner emphasized the importance of heredity in evolution, of processes conserved through reproduction. As Darwin already observed, evolution occurs through a combination of heredity and development, through the production of variation and the filter of natural selection. Kirschner pointed out that evolvability is a property of all biological processes and pointed to a number of strategies that make organisms as evolvable as they are, strategies from which contemporary biotechnology seeks to learn. In his article, Kiesler went on to consider the history of tools and technological environments in evolutionary terms. Just as all living organisms are generated through their own species from a long chain of generations, he said, so do man-made objects generate from a long line of older ideologies or objects of similar functions. Thus, a contemporary chair, for instance, is the product of many generations of other tools for man to rest his body in fatigue. This is heredity in technology. He discussed how the design of standard types of tools evolved through variation, specialization, new material processes, and the drive for ever greater efficiency. Above all, he pointed out that it is through the evolution of the technological environment, which constitutes a whole system of tools, that humanity itself has evolved, rather than through the evolution of its own organism or body, which would, of course, take much longer. Technology has enabled humanity to develop capabilities far in excess of its body. These capabilities and experiences, he wrote, are transmitted to the next generation, not biologically, but through customs and habits, training and education, what he called social heredity. To be true to his initial diagram, Kiesler emphasized, however, that change requires interaction among the spheres of the human, the technological, and the natural, and depends not only on environment, but on potentials already inherent in human physiology. He then went on to redefine design as biotechnique, which he carefully distinguished from the biotechnics of the 1920s. He reserved that term, biotechnics, for nature's method of building, not for humanities. In contrast, biotechnique flows from what he called the special skill of man, which he has developed to influence life in a desired direction. In 1937, he had established the Laboratory of Design Correlation at Columbia University's School of Architecture in order to develop new methods for building design and to test the validity of biotechniques through actual constructions. A year and a half of study into book storing resulted in this design, which was to take the strain off the user by making the system itself flexible. Each individual unit, as well as the entire assembly, rotates 360 degrees. The total assembly can be moved easily from one location to another, capacity can be easily increased or reduced by addition or subtraction of individual units. While he did not do this himself, allow me to show you some parallel work he was doing at exactly the same time on the potential of tools and technological environments to extend the human sensorium and perception. I love this image. The caption reads, "We live through co-realism. Science, art, and philosophy try to make us understand this fact more and more, deeper and deeper, richer and richer. All our being is conditioned by the connectedness of co-realism." Or here is one of a number of sketches of extended senses, studies in perception in the late 30s and early 40s. What's missing, he writes here, in the body is the ability to see through and into objects. We don't have Superman vision yet. He also did studies for what he called a vision machine, such as this, which are clearly organismic in character. In his article on co-realism, Kiesler elaborated the distinction between biotechnique and biotechnic in another way as well, under the rubric of continuous construction, which brings us closer to the concerns of many designers today. Where nature builds by cell division with the aim of continuity, man, he said, can only build by joining parts together into structures without continuity. But because man-made joints are ultimately subject to nature's forces, he concluded, building design should now aim to reduce the number of joints, making for higher resistance, higher rigidity, easier maintenance, and lower costs. I love the pragmatism of it. Such considerations had already led him to explore continuous construction in the Endless Theater Project of 1923, shown here. Endless Theater Project, which I'm not showing here, and the partially realized Space Stage of 1924 in Vienna, which is what this image is showing. And then he developed it more fully in his Space House of 1933 once he'd arrived in New York. And of course, it's most explicit in his well-known and sustained pursuit of the 1950s and early 1960s of the Endless Project for the Endless House. And with the Endless House, of course, we can all breathe a sigh of relief having finally arrived at biomorphic forms, which we're so much more comfortable with, familiar with in discussions of biology today. Compared with today's theories of biology, coevolution, and ecosystem interactivity, Raoul Francais' Biotechniques and its adaptations by artists, architects such as Lissitzky, Moholy-Nagy, and Kiesler may seem crude, still overly reliant on morphological and cellular analogies, not yet informed by anything like genetics, let alone as was the embryology of its day, also not informed by that. It was silent with respect to the mechanisms of generation, notwithstanding their desire to think in constitutive and generative terms. Nevertheless, their work reveals that a shift in focus was already taking place then, from form to the processes of formation, to dynamic constitutive systems and ecologies, building blocks, modules and techniques, evolution and diversity. This shift was important for rethinking technology in biologistic terms, across scales and across media, exploring new capabilities and potentials within the ongoing process whereby organisms and environments, which we share with other species, evolve through interaction, transformation, disassembly, and reassembly. As our generation and the next several generations confront humanity's ever greater presence on the planet and seek in their own way to integrate technology more smoothly with nature's dynamics, it is salutary to recognize that we are by no means the first to have had such ambitions. Nor are we the first to seek a paradigm shift or to be constrained by the technologies and epistemes already at play. Recognizing our own impulses and ideas in seemingly unlikely precursors such as Lissitzky may remind us that our knowledge and our efforts too are necessarily limited, blind to what we don't know, don't yet know, which is a lot, and will ultimately be superseded in time. It seems pretty clear, to me at least, that nature will continue to elude the grasp of human consciousness and control, notwithstanding our capacity to expand both of those. At the same time, the resonances between contemporary experimental architecture and work of the historical avant-garde suggests that we be more deliberate in sorting out the differences and similarities between then and now, that some of the most interesting parts of this history were forgotten in the campaign to forge a unified, hegemonic modern movement, should be salutary too, a reminder that we no longer really need to do that. that the insistent pursuit of a universal ism has, thankfully, subsided, or at least largely so. Instead, by nurturing the culture of experimentation and diversity, a more heterogeneous, inclusive, and open-ended alternative has emerged to monolithic, exclusionary, and dogmatic conceptions of architectural practice. A fuller treatment of the history I've offered today would, of course, need to distinguish between the use of science to legitimate the totalizing claims of modernists and even of some contemporary architects, and its use as stimulus for the production of difference that does not seek to assimilate to new totalities. Contemporary bioconstructivists participate in the evolution of society and the planet through the production of unassimilable diversity, one experiment at a time, one project at a time, one career at a time. They produce variation through a myriad of small genetic changes to inherited modes of form, construction, functionality, and relationship with environment. Such variations are then subject to selection, repetition, and dissemination, which has to be sustained in time in order to consolidate a true evolution. That is, I believe, what we are seeing in practice today, the combination of variation and selection. And we should celebrate and theorize it. In this respect, we are indeed allied with Darwin when he explained that evolution, in fact, depends on the production of diversity, in his words, on the creation of endless forms most beautiful. Thank you.
Let me see if this is turned on. Nick, can we do? Detlef, thanks very much. Thank you for the talk. Can I open it up to questions? Give you a minute or two to formulate that question. I'd like to ask one, looking at the work, and I mean, it's a remarkable history, as you describe it, a prehistory to a certain modern sensibility that's obviously being constructed through the history itself that you're writing. And I think many of us want to ask questions about how one imagines, how definitive one imagines this connection between a sensibility that's emerging in the 1920s, mm-hmm. which it's hard for many of us to not want to connect to much more immediate, recent past. In the way you've configured this description of the work, what's being foregrounded is clearly biomorphic form, formal appearance, whether representational or not, of the figure, the architectural figure. One of the interesting things that falls out, and I made a note halfway through your talk that's remarkable, is that in a way you're also tracking the emergence of a particular architectural idea, which is the cellular configuration of material, steel beams, columns, which and when you go forward then to people like Friotto, suddenly starts to have a prehistory to the particular structural experiments of someone like Otto or Fuller, which we think of really just in the history of space frames and engineering. And I'm wondering if, in the research that you're doing in someone like Mies, if there might be a way in which you're configuring also the history of the lattice structure, almost, which is a very interesting modern invention, you could say, by architects and engineers. That is, when I'm thinking of the interest today in that as a topic, a sudden fascination with tessellation, gridded, cellular, space frame type structures, which are built into wireframe modeling and all kinds of technologies that we use today, if in fact you're providing a very interesting opening up to that kind of prehistory also, which again doesn't seem like it's being emphasized in this particular description, but it was hard not to observe that coming out in the material.
I mean, examples you're giving, even if you go to Fuller, are really post-war, right? And
yeah.
So it's another historical moment, and the Lurikale is also in that.
Yeah, of course.
That scene, and all of those figures did indeed appreciate the microscopic sea creatures that I showed at one point, which were very the Haeckel things, and. That's a story that I've actually written in the essay I published in Lars's book Knox on Machining Architecture, which is one of you know great paradoxes too. And I like the paradoxes as much as the sense that here is a heroic agenda of research into structure. instance, it was discovered by another by subsequent scientists that Haeckel drew. You know, he made these drawings by looking through a microscope and then drawing by hand, right? Mm. And he already had a theory that all organic matter, all living matter, was essentially crystalline, mm. And so he was finding greater continuities, greater consistencies, geometric consistencies, and then were really there. So the radiolarians that are now studied show imperfections. They show places where the matrix is off, and or you know, and there are other conundrums that are presented that way. So you know, in a sense, the desire to find the universal element, you know, the one universal element out of which everything would be built, has within it some kind of a cosmological wish more than a scientifically based reality. And so maybe also in that respect, the development of parametrics from this more uniform matrix is consistent, more consistent with the evidence in nature than they thought in that generation. I think that we see rhetorically, at least, in terms of the theory, the words that are used, a lot of very similar ideas again and again. Right? Find the fundamental element of all the creation. This is an ancient idea. Right? This is not just a 20th century idea. Find it in crystals, or find it in living organisms, or find it in technology. And we see it given different shape, different appearance by designers, by engineers, by scientists. What do we make of that? Right? Is that a useful trope? Is that a useful thought structure? Does it have its own limitations? If we line up the variations, what do we make of that? In part, that's what I'm hoping to be promoting, is stepping back a little bit from some of the, let's call them thought structures, for want of a better word, that we fall into by virtue of seeing that those very same thought structures had already been in play in very different time and in different formulae. So in Lissitzky's time, same idea, but manifest in planes that were the elemental unit, not in structs, and manifest in planes that could be different sizes and shapes, could even become three-dimensional blocks. Mm. Right, so it's a different kit of parts. It's less reductive, actually, but it's still pretty reductive, pretty atomistic. I'm not sure that answers
the
question.
The trophy that you seem to be returning to, as you look at the presentation, that the trope of the cell or lattice type structure is remarkably durable to move from the 20s
remarkably durable
forward.
Right. I mean that in fact the tower no longer becomes something we're trying to understand in terms of the shape of the figure, but that it's simply itself a three-dimensional lattice structure,
mm-hmm.
writ large.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, and when you think of the work, and I'm remembering Ross Krauss, I think, writes in your book on Mies, a nice essay on the grid, a version of her chapter, a famous chapter on the grid becoming immaterial in modern art, that in a way what architects are doing also with the grid is converting it into a three-dimensional organizational idea, which then now plays itself through in
mm-hmm.
remarkably
mm-hmm.
different but
mm-hmm.
highly productive ways, it looks like.
Right.
It creates for some space frames, for some a sort of three-dimensional crystalline form, and for others.
This is in many ways still the great virtue of recourse to scientific models or to these tropes, is that they help sponsor
new
inventions, right?
Yeah.
And so you in effect have to forget the old ones, right? They have to be discharged from cultural memory, and so maybe I'm doing something that's rather perverse and wrong-headed by trying to bring that material back again.
Nice.
It's interesting to think about Mies in this context because he ultimately, it seems to me, tempers his reception of biology by other issues. And so you get the new National Gallery, which is a matrix, a two-way spanning structure.
Exactly.
But it's unbelievably heavy, right? And it's black. And it could crush you, right? It's being held up by nothing. And so it's a tour de force of engineering invention by being held up with nothing, but at the same time, it's ambivalent. It's not solving a problem, you know, for all of humanity. It's not finding the ultimate solution. He's interesting that way. It's hard to make a definitive interpretation of this, but he's not like one of the other figures of the 20s who is a reader of Raoul France is Hannes Meyer. And Meyer writes a manifesto in 1926 called Building, in which he says that building is biology. And then if you take this, you know, literally, and you look again at Meyer's work, you see a more straightforward high tech, if you want, use of nature than someone like Mies, right? Where it's never going to be as technocratic and as put to work that way. Yeah.
Could I open it up to questions? Anybody?
Hi, Detlef. So I was wondering what's your, maybe from the examples that you were showing, it seems that there was lots of ideas were coming from a kind of current scientific thought of the time as well, which was obviously Darwin just happening before that. And currently, maybe if we would try to potentially project certain shift that could, if we are very optimistic, could happen right now in the domain of design, would be this kind of access to larger, let's say, data populations or different kind of mathematics that I think resonate really well with your with Franze and a kind of ideas of biotechnic or certain laws of nature rather than a kind of shapes of nature. So do you think that this kind of access to new types of laws or new types of, I'll be quite explicit, computational material or mm-hmm. matter, could produce a certain other types of understanding in design rather than mm-hmm. this kind of biomorphic or somehow based on a, a representational aspects of biology.
I mean, you're almost in a better position to answer that question than I am, given that you work on this, right? And I mean, it seems to me that we're at a very interesting moment where it's possible and even necessary for those who've been working on form to also be working on performance, right? To be taking up the things that usually we assume, you know, the high-tech folks are more engaged in, questions of energy, questions of, you know, certain kinds of optimization. Even if you're critical of, you know, the classic forms of optimization, there may be others that are related to the production of increased complexity, but still are cognizant of or trying to work through the questions of the optimal. I think that's the point where it becomes more interesting again, right? That rather than perpetuating a division between formalists and functionalists or something like that, that we just say all of these things now need to be brought to bear. And indeed, one of the things I find interesting is that that lots of different models are able to be employed, right? And worked with. I think my concluding remarks are really in the spirit of saying we don't need to worry about coming up with a big ism, right? If it happens, it will be fantastic, all right? If it happens, but maybe that's too bold a proposition, and that rather, like Darwin, what we should be doing is just proliferating lots and lots of options. And it's great that, you know, one person does one thing, another person's going to go off and do something else, and then let's see what comes out of that, right? Maybe we then test it. That would be another part of the new, another stage in the development of all of this work is testing it, right? What's going to be able to be generalized? What can actually go out into the larger world, and what can't, and why can't it? I think we're, again, at a point where, you know this better than I do, it's possible to make extraordinary things, but maybe not at large scale, or maybe not at the scale of populations, in fact, right, of entire cities. We can still maybe make only small things or fragments of larger things. there's something to be learned in that that's akin to, you know, learning about evolution, right? It's like sometimes the things that nature produced didn't go anywhere. It produces aberrations constantly, eccentric forms, eccentric animals. It's got that history to it. I also am interested in saying somewhere along the way that the world of straight up and down architecture is equally biological, right, to what we think of as biomorphic. How can it not be, would be my proposition, right? In that respect, I suppose I'm a kind of deep ecologist, right? I mean, I don't see there being any outside to nature. We're not outside it. We're in it. Whatever it is, we're as much in it as anything else is. And so that means, by definition, the building we're in is a biological construct. It's our environmental construct. So maybe the question isn't, you know, biology good and mechanism bad or something like that, or straight up and down bad, but rather that we need to develop other categories of evaluation to be able to say that something is good or bad. I can't foresee the bulk of the physical environment not being straight up and down. I can't see that. So in what ways can it become also, you know, richer and more complex? And indeed it can, right? And it is. There are many examples of extraordinarily complex architecture that are made of straight up and down elements. That's why I was saying at the outset, too, the orthogonal universe is a subset of the larger universe of complex and nonlinear behaviors. If that's the case, it may be very useful in certain ways, just like the theory of gravity is useful to a certain point, right? And then it isn't useful in other contexts. But in certain contexts, it's extremely helpful. And I think that's what we basically as a species have been discovering. And so we're proliferating other options, formal options, as it becomes possible for us to do that, because maybe in the history of humanity too, this kind of architecture was being done at for a moment along that timeline. Before that, it was actually hard to make things straight up and down, right? People were making things kind of lopsided, and floors weren't level, and roofs were collapsing, and Gothic cathedrals were falling down. And indeed, we had the Baroque, and we had the Gothic, and we had things that weren't trabeated. The non-classical tradition. So maybe that's a ramble, but that's part of my motive in this, is to say that if these guys were thinking about what looked to us like old-fashioned industrial mechanical technology as biological, maybe it's not just that they're completely wrong.
It seems like we are getting back to that almost.
I was wondering, you spoke quite a lot about biology, biological examples. Where does some of the thoughts that were happening at this time had a lot also to do with the spirit?
With experience.
Spirit.
Spirit.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And I was wondering where that, how that fits into the idea of biotechniques and techniques. Because I'm reminded of the crystal chain letters.
Right.
Where the writings are a little bit,
mystical.
Mystic. Yeah. But the drawings are something else.
Yeah.
Sometimes I don't feel it to be as utopic as they like to think of it as. Uh-huh. But they are quite constructive in the drawings themselves.
I mean, there are a number of different things that you've touched on. Maybe if I start with the last things about the crystal chain group, it's nice to have that here, right? And obviously this will be part of the larger project, right? I would have to have them in this mix. And we do see biomorphic form there, right? Hermann Finsterlin, blobs galore, right? They're fabulous fantasies, often even, thought of in materials like glass. Amazing to imagine. There are also figures who are using faceted crystalline geometries and who are making things out of nets and lines. And so it's actually a pretty rich moment of experimentation. And it's all just in drawings, right? They're not even making models. It's sketches, usually, for that matter. But pretty lateral and diverse. And so in fact, the history of biomorphic form dovetails with the history I've been describing, right? It's not that it happens all later. I'm just a little overstating that in the lecture. It's actually, they're kind of happening in parallel. There's obviously aspects of Art Nouveau and of kind of architectural symbolist work of the 1890s that would also need to be thought about here. The issue of spirit is a big one because, of course, so many figures are either, you know, actually, you know, have deep religious convictions. Tout did, or their thought is in a mystical tradition, which is again slightly different, or it's simply transcendental that they're interested in, you know, something that goes beyond the human and is no longer maybe about, you know, literal participation in liturgies, etc., but rather is thinking the question of the divine in a quasi-secular way, right, is moving away from religion and into theology and from theology into philosophy. And, you know, many of the scientific writers of this period will talk about spirit. They will talk about it. Franze, interestingly, does not. And he's criticized by that for that by some of the artists who are interested in his writings. What does one make of it? I'm not sure exactly. You know, in Mies' case, it's a big thing, and it is again that kind of way of tempering the preoccupations with biology that spirit comes in, and it is the transcendentalizing. It's no longer we're no longer in a world that could be, you know, to speak with Deleuze, a world of immanence, right? A world that is in the here and now, right? That is on earth, that is not concerned with some recourse to higher authorities, but is rather looking for governance from this world, and is also the force, if you want, behind the development of democracy and the various revolutions to take power out of the hands of kings and princes and bishops and popes and put it into the hands of the people. So, you know, the question of spirit, it's a huge question. And I'm not sure that I have the apparatus to handle it. There is a nice book by Giorgio Agamben that has within it a history of the notion of spirit in several different languages, in French, in German, in English. It's reiterations and transformations over, you know, 400 years of modern history. And that's probably a better thing to go to than me on this topic.
I was thinking this kind of approach in history has always been very sublime or abstract. It has never been explicit. I mean, until the time maybe Mies or. I mean, I was wondering why has it been so abstract? Not talked about explicitly.
Why is abstraction embraced here?
Yeah.
Okay. I think that's again a very interesting question. Maybe one way of answering it, and there are probably a dozen, but one way of answering it would be to go back to the history of geometry, which is very abstract, right? And yet, geometry is inherent in what we consider to be reality, in material reality. The ancient mathematics was primarily preoccupied with proving the existence of geometric entities, right? So Euclid's postulates are all about demonstrations of the existence of these entities, triangles, squares, whatever. In Descartes' geometry, which is only, you know, late 17th century text, that's the first time that we see geometry being thought of in a constructive sense, in a sense that is detached from the prior existence of geometric entities, that is seen as now a way of producing new entities that has this forward projective dimension. And I think operates in the subsequent reception in architecture and aesthetic theory and in a variety of forms as a counterpoint or weapon even against existing representations. If we think about the 18th century critiques of semiotic language or of received forms of representation, and then their recourse to natural models, in fact, to the image of the noble savage, right, the original human being, the original hut, etc. We also begin to see a greater emphasis on geometry in architecture. Right, neoclassical work is more abstract, is more geometricized, and then over the course of what we think of as, you know, modernism per se, geometry and abstract form is used as a way to get out of the reproduction of historical styles, right, the replication of historical styles, and is seen as something that is inherently more true or authentic or natural or et cetera. I think it's also inherently generative, right, because of this shift that occurs in the history of mathematics in the 17th century. It's a tool that allows you to imagine generating new things that have not already been precedented.
I have to apologize, my question won't be as sophisticated. But I was just curious, why is it when one goes into the Yale Center for British Art and one senses quite a large group of people say it's eternal, and why does something like Buckminster Fuller's work, when it's much more literal, or any sort of amorphous architecture, doesn't feel eternal to us? Hmm. Why do we, based on this lecture, you would tend to think it's the other way around?
Hmm. Well, I mean, certainly both of them, I would imagine, aspire to producing things that would generate the feeling of the eternal. I mean, in Kahn's case, you know, his experiences in Rome were so formative for his later work, right, that he was in fact looking for a new monumentality that would have the same sense of the eternal as he experienced in the ruins of Rome. Fuller is looking for something that is essential, maybe more than eternal even. I'm not sure that, I'm trying to think of where in his writings, you know, we come across the eternal. But maybe it's got, you know, for many of us, the difference is weight. Right? I mean, the mass quality of Kahn's buildings are so much a part of the monumental tradition and the tradition of buildings being trying to be durable in time, right? Just not being movable, not being erodible. And in Fuller, that's not the case. He's happy for it to be lightweight, and wants it to be lighter, wants it to be, you know, floating, wants it to be able to be taken apart and put back together again. And there isn't the same commitment to durability, although there is a desire for something cosmologically essential, something maybe of that nature.